Hello everyone, welcome to Imperfect Skin. My name is Judith and I'm here to help you to achieve the best skin you can possibly have with a proper skincare routine. So make sure you subscribe to the channel and turn on the notification bell so that you don't miss out any of the upcoming video. Today we are going to discuss about the sunscreen controversies. If you are a skincare enthusiast, you should already know about this issue. The recent hype controversy related to sunscreens started back in December of 2020 when one of the best-selling sunscreen under the brand of Purito failed to meet the SPF claim on the bottle. So this issue actually shocked the whole skincare community because the sunscreen was tested as SPF 19 instead of the claimed SPF 50. So afterwards, a few other well-known Korean sunscreens had failed the SPF test as well, such as the Klairs and also Kipul, which in overall is quite disappointing. In April 2021, which is this year, Krave Beauty, a popular brand founded by the skinfluencers Lia, also announced the discontinuation of sales for their Beet the Shield sunscreen because of the failure in meeting the claimed SPF. The whole situation is just really sad and, to be honest, pretty confusing for consumer like us. Korea is well known for their advancement in skincare and beauty industry, so to have so many well-known Korean sunscreen failing on their SPF claims is just quite shocking. So, is this issue only affecting the Korean sunscreens? Well, sadly, no. Back in 2016, Consumers Reports have found that 23 out of 60 US sunscreens they investigated tested at less than half of their labeled SPF. And in October 2020, the Hong Kong Consumer Council had found that 25 out of the 30 Asian sunscreens had less than their SPF claim. This inclusive of Japan sunscreen, Korean sunscreen, and even the Western sunscreens. And then on the 12th of May, based on the latest update from the New Zealand Consumer Council, it is also reported that 5 out of the 12 sunscreens that they tested failed the SPF claims. So as you can see from here, this is no longer a brand issue or an issue related to sunscreen from just a specific region like Korea or Asian sunscreen. It is an entire sunscreen industry issue. Yes, I do understand that mistakes could actually happen, especially with the complexity of the SPF testing.
Sunscreens are annoyingly complicated. The saying that the ingredients list can't tell you the whole story about how a product works is especially applicable to sunscreens. Cosmetic formulators know this really well because sunscreens are one of the hardest things to formulate. It can take months to finish a sunscreen. One cosmetic chemist told me that she just finished formulating a sunscreen and it took her 6 months, and she started with an SPF 30 base and she just had to raise the SPF. So obviously protection isn't just about the amounts of filters you put into it, because if it was, then they'd be done in a day.
However, when mistakes happen with the product that is supposed to help us to prevent skin cancer, it is pretty much unacceptable and there should be zero excuse to this. So if you want to know more about how SPF is being tested, check out Let Muffin Beauty Science. I will definitely link her channel in the description box. The whole skincare industry, the dermatologists, skincare influencers have been literally broadcasting to everyone the importance of sun protection and then go on and sell the sunscreen products that do not really live up to the claims. Like, come on, we need more accountability from the industry experts, the brands, and also the regulators. Now, do I really think that brands are fully responsible on this? Honestly, not at all. I do not think that all the brands involved are intentionally being deceptive towards the customers, but there are some loopholes and some serious flaws in how sunscreen products are being tested, manufactured, and sold.
I'll try to sum it up quickly. ODM 1 and ODM 2 originally created two cream formulas for sunscreens. They provided a UV protection of SPF 50+. These two sunscreens were tested by an official inspection agency approved by the Korean authorities, which confirmed their SPF rating. And this was enough for the Ministry of Food and Drug Safety, what people usually call the Korean FDA, to approve the products to be sold on the market. After this approval, ODM 1 and ODM 2 decided to tweak the formula to improve application and feeling on the skin. And they tried to use a legal loophole to avoid pre-market review by the Korean authorities. In short, this scandal comes down to a handful of companies trying to use a loophole to avoid pre-market tests. Only to point fingers at the Korean regulations when they got caught.
So for more information related to this, YouTuber Odell Mondot had a detailed video about this, so I will link the video in the description box. If you're interested about this, just check it out. Of course, in the ideal world, it would be good if the brands and also the manufacturers, even the regulators, are being accountable with the sunscreen products that are being released to the market. But as a consumer, what can we do other than relying on the accountability of this? So the first one, we should apply enough sunscreen. My personal trick is to use at least 3 fingers worth of sunscreen and apply more whenever it is not enough. Just don't be like Gwyneth Paltrow.
I'm not a sort of head-to-toe slather of sunscreen, but I like to put some kind of on my nose and the area where the sun really hits.
Cover all the exposed skin area, not just the high points of your face where, well, according to Gwyneth, where the sun hits. That doesn't make sense. Just apply enough. And other than applying enough sunscreen, it is equally important to make sure that you reapply every 2 to 3 hours as needed, especially if you are out in the sun. As for the choice of sunscreen, try to look for a good mix of filters and a broad spectrum coverage. Let me know if you would like me to do a video regarding how I choose my sunscreen. Please leave a comment down below if you want to know more about this. Well, even though sunscreen is important and we should definitely not leave it out, we should also not just rely on sunscreen for sun protection. Wear protective clothing and also try to stay out of the sun, especially during the peak hours, would be really helpful as well. So, right now, the important question, do you need to throw out the sunscreen that do not meet the claims of the SPF? Well, absolutely not. The differences actually between SPF 19 and SPF 30 is not really overwhelmingly different. Well, of course, it is fair if you are no longer using it or no longer feel comfortable using it as your primary SPF, but you can still use them for your hands or when you are staying indoors where you're not really directly under the sun. If you're one of those claiming that, well, I'm not really confident with sunscreens and there is so much controversy about sunscreens that maybe it would be better for you not to use sunscreen at all, well, hold it right there. You definitely need to wear sunscreen. Despite all of this mess, despite of how difficult it is to find a sunscreen that is right for you, trust me, it's really, really hard, but you still need to wear a sunscreen. The cost of not wearing a sunscreen is definitely far greater than wearing a sunscreen. You know, most of the time, sun protection is definitely better than no protection at all. So even if you don't want to care about like sunburn, premature aging, there is also an increased risk of skin cancer as well. Cancer, how scary is that, right? So whatever reason it is, sunscreen in fact is non-negotiable. So please apply your sunscreen. What do you think about this video? If you have any comments or if you have any sunscreens that you personally like, please leave a comment down below. I would definitely love to know more about it. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and turn on the notification bell so that you don't miss out any of the upcoming video. I will see you guys next time. Bye!